It may look like I have been rotated by 45 degrees, but I assure you, I have not been rotated. Not a single pixel you are looking at right now has been rotated around anything. But the pixels have been skewed. It turns out, mathematically, three consecutive skew transformations can give you the same result as a rotation. So you can make something look rotated without rotating it, which is a wonderful bit of mathematics with some really interesting properties, which I mean, I love, but arguably these days are slightly obsolete. Quick AOB, Jane Street's Academy of Math and Programming closes applications this March 13th. More details at the end of the video. Why would we want to rotate something without rotating it? Well, here's our original Mario. And back in the days when things were very low resolution, you may remember the past, fewer pixels. It was hard to rotate things because yes, Mario's rotating now, but the pixels are moving with Mario. And I get so annoyed when I see like lo-fi, low-bit animations, but the pixels themselves move. No, the pixels are a grid. They don't move. So as Mario's rotating, we have to work out how do we fill in the pixels within the grid to make Mario look like they're rotating. To show you what happens when Mario rotates properly, my friend Andrew Taylor coded this up where I can rotate Mario and look at it. What a nightmare. Like if I put him, like what's up with Mario's face there? Like, is there a word? Okay, I apologize to whatever I've done to Mario there. And if I put Mario back up the correct way, you can see in the normal orientation, every pixel is working hard because there aren't many pixels to go around. And the buttons, the two yellow buttons on Mario's plumbing overalls, you can see it's just one pixel per button. When I rotate it, as those yellow pixels go in and out of the rest of the grid, like if you were doing a proper rotation, you got to work out, well, which ones do we color in? And sometimes they'll cover two possible ones, and sometimes they won't even be in one. So if I rotate Mario, watch the buttons, you can see they start off there, still fine. One disappears. That one is no longer filling enough of any one pixel to be able to see it. If we keep going around, there's back, there's two. Oh wait, one gets long there, because at one point it's covering both. So the issue with rotating the image, the sprite properly, and then working out what new pixel color each of them should be because of the average of the old pixels that happen to overlay it, is that your pixels are no longer working strategically individually. New plan, forget rotating, we're only gonna skew, because skewing just involves sliding the pixels in either a horizontal or a vertical direction. So they're not gonna move off grid. And as long as we do a whole number of sliding, it'll match back up again. So here we go. There's our friend Mario. I've reset Mario. We're gonna start by doing a skew transformation. So we slide the top half back and the bottom half forward. And so we've moved, looks like Mario's moving at speed, I guess. We've moved Mario over a little bit. We're now gonna do a second skew transformation where we do it in the vertical direction system. It skews the other way like that. And then we do one last transformation where we actually repeat the first one again. We do another horizontal skew, and that's gonna look like this. And there you are. And now you're like, well, hang on. Mario looks like they've rotated. Yes, their nose, there's something going on with the nose there. It's not perfect. The point is, we managed to rotate Mario without doing anything other than horizontal or vertical movements. In fact, I'm gonna reset this Mario. Let's try a different angle. So we start with another skew. Oh, other way this time, interesting. And then we skew up, and then we skew across again. And now there's our new Mario rotated. But what's interesting about this is because, the rotations aren't perfect. We're still limited by the number of pixels, but none of the pixels change. Watch the whole transformation. And I'll keep switching to other rotations here. Because we're only sliding the pixels, we're not changing them at all, you still end up with all the same pixels just in new locations. So this preserves all pixels. Both buttons are there. If there's an important pixel, it's guaranteed to survive. Three skews give you a rotation without changing the pixels involved. The same transformations work on much higher resolution images. So you're looking at me in 4K, and I've written my own terrible Python code to be able to skew me in different directions. So everything you saw before was Andrew Taylor's excellent code. My code, not so great. In fact, I have to manually go through and find the frame where I want to start. So I'm going to clap and we'll do the first skew. That's so I can find it later. There we are. So now I've been skewed. You can see my the top half here. I've skewed that way. I mean, you can already see this. And the bottom half, I've gone the other way. So I've now done one skew. We're one skew in. The second skew is going to be a vertical one. So again, we'll do it on a clap. There we are. Now, my aspect ratio is not great, but we're 2/3 of the way through. One last skew. And I look normal again. I look totally normal, but it looks like I've been rotated by 45 degrees. I haven't. I've just been skewed 3 times. And now, the longer I talk, the more my laptop is going to have to do later because my code is deeply, deeply inefficient. But it works. Like, and I'm proud. I wrote it myself because, yes, you could probably just do this in, like, off-the-shelf software. It'd be way quicker and way easier and way probably even cheaper now I think about it. But the point is, I didn't want to just, you know, do a skew effect. I wanted to manually, and by manual I mean with Python code, move every single pixel the correct amount. And that's why I'm very, very proud of this. Although for every minute I'm talking like this, it's over 3 hours of render time. My code is not so much Blender as it is a juice loosener. So we're going to stop this right now. We have 2 pressing questions now. One is, how do we know? Come on. How do we know that any rotation can be achieved by 3 skew transformations? And secondly, assuming that is true, how do we work out? Like, how much skew do you need for a specific angle you want to rotate through? We can answer both those questions, and we will. But first, we have to have a closer look at what a skew transformation actually is. So against my better judgment, I'm going to put my laptop back through its paces later, and I'm going to re-skew this shot. There you are. I've gone this way at the top and that way at the bottom. And you know what? Just take a moment to have a look at this transformation. So actually, if I come back down to the middle, I mean, I'm over here and down here. Look at that, right? Actually, if we mark the exact middle of the frame, and this is my 0 point. I'm using the center of the frame as my origin. Everything above that is positive in the y direction, and below that is negative. If I overlay skewed mat with original mat, you can see that everything on the midpoint, on the line, doesn't move. It's not skewed at all. And the further I am away from that line, the more I get skewed. And that's because it's just a linear transformation. This is the actual line that's going to point at it. I don't know where I'm pointing anymore. Somewhere on the screen is the actual line of code I use to do this in my juice loosener code. And all I'm doing is for the X and Y coordinates for every single pixel, I'm not touching the Y. The Y stays exactly where it is, nothing's going up and down. The X coordinate is the same as the old X coordinate, but that entire row is bumped along proportional to its Y value. It's a linear smear to the side. So the y coordinate is just how far above or below that line is, and then we go that far. Above is positive, and that's the positive direction, whereas blue line is negative, which is why I go over there. So, oh, and I have also put on a modular, the horizontal width of this. So I've done some weird, I mean, I don't even know where the edges of the frame are. I don't, there's probably some real ridiculous edge cases I've forgotten about. So there you go. And in fact, at the very end of this video, the last shot will be me doing a full 360 rotation using my terrible Python code. But for now, I'm going to stop this skew and we're going to talk a little bit about how we represent it mathematically. Mathematically, if we start with a vector, that's our X and Y coordinates of any given pixel, we're going to transform that so the Y hasn't changed, but the X, now we add on some percentage, some ratio of the Y coordinate, which I'm just going to call A for the first transformation. And if you're familiar with matrix multiplication, you'll realize you can achieve that by just multiplying it by a matrix. Isn't that great? If you haven't done this before, you'll have to trust me. You don't have to trust me. You can go and learn how to multiply matrices and double check it. If you can't be bothered, then you're going to have to trust me. Now, a vertical skew, very, very similar. And then we want a final third horizontal skew. So there are 3 matrices which describe the 3 skew transformations. So doing all 3 of them and matrices, tricky, multiply them in the right order. None of this swapping the order anymore.
Write that down in your workbooks now.
You have to trust me and or learn. So if we do multiply all 3 of them together, this is the grand result. That's the one big matrix which shows what happens when we do all 3 skews, one after the other.
If you want to rotate something, you can also use a matrix. This is the matrix that represents rotation by some angle, in this case, theta. And again, you can either trust me or you can look it up, your choice. And all we have to do now is show that this three skew matrix is the same as the rotation matrix. And we can do that because it's just a bunch of simultaneous equations. We've got four equations here and we have to solve them. Now that can be done, but I can't, it's too much for the video. Andrew Taylor, who was the first person who showed me all of this, has done a fantastic proof. There you are, Andrew's proof, very nice. Has some Pythagoras in it, if you saw it at the end there. I'll link to that below. The point is, you can solve it, and it gives you some really nice results, as well as showing you that yes, the matrices are equivalent. On top of that, you realize that the two horizontal skews are identical. A and C are the same amount of skew, and they equal the tan of half the angle you want to rotate through. And then the vertical skew is the sine of the whole angle you want to rotate through. Although one of them has to be negative. Either the tan's negative and the sine's positive, or sine's negative, tan's positive. Depends if you're rotating clockwise or anticlockwise. But that's it. That's how you work out your two skew amounts that you need to move horizontally, vertically, and then horizontally again. I thought it'd be nice to actually show those in action, and given that this act of skewing doesn't create nor destroy pixels, I realized I could do this with physical pixels. So here comes my second terrible idea in this video. I've made a physical version of the classic Minecraft sword, which is in a 16 by 16 grid. The sword nicely is on a 45 degree angle, but let's say we want to rotate that another, or something a bit unusual, 30 degrees. Let's spin it another 30 degrees. There's no like center pixel because it's even in both directions. So what I'm going to do is rotate it around this one here. So if I take out that one pixel there and replace it with an orange pixel, now you can keep track of the exact center of this image in theory. Oh, we don't really need the background. That's just there. So when I'm moving things around, they all kind of stay together. So I'm going to label, so we can refer to it later, horizontal, that's where we're starting, and we'll put in the vertical, which is going to be through that column there. So, given we want to move this sword 30 degrees clockwise, we need to do a positive tan skew, a negative sine, a positive tan. And if we look at the numbers on our rows, we've got the 0th row, and then 1 up through 8, and then we've got negative 1 down through 7. We need to multiply each of those by the tan of half of our angle, the tan of 15. And these are just terrible, terrible numbers. But if we round them all off to the nearest whole number, that's how much we're going to do the skew by. So we can see that all three of these are going to stay where they are. The next four have to go 1. So there is the top half of our horizontal skew, and now it's symmetric, so 1. There we go. So now we've got a slightly wider, we've smeared it out ever so slightly. All the pixels are still here. We need to do our negative sine skew, which means the positive direction is going to go down and the negative direction is going to go up. And these numbers are a little bit bigger. Very nicely, the sine of 30 degrees is a half. So every 2 we go across this way, we go 1 that way. So we actually leave the central 0th line where it is, 1. Like that.
Future Matt here. Yes, past Matt is skewing that the wrong way in the vertical direction. Accidentally doing a positive skew out of habit. Needs to be negative sine, which totally messes it up. It should have looked like this. Yes, I fixed it in post. And if we now apply the remaining horizontal skew, you can see that still looks pretty much like the Minecraft sword. And you can argue that is now 75 degrees tilted down from the vertical. So I think that, within the resolution of the pixels, is a success. Unlike the horrific mess past Matt ended up with.
This looks like a sword. It's still pretty terrifying. If anything, it's now sharper than ever before. More pointy. I think that worked well enough, and now you see how the system works. And before we show the final full rotation of me, I want to thank the sponsor of this video, Jane Street. Specifically, their Academy of Math and Programming is closing applications on the 13th of March. So the day before Pi Day. And you will have heard me mention this in a previous video when applications opened, but the Academy of Math and Programming, I think, is such a fantastic opportunity. If you or someone you know is a recent high school graduate who's thinking of going into some area of mathematics or computer science, or even like things involving game theory or data analysis, this is a residential program. It's in New York City. It runs from very late June until very early August in 2024. All costs are covered, and Jane Street will give all participants a $5,000 scholarship to help them with their future education. It's for anyone who's recently graduated from high school and has experienced some kind of obstacle in their education thus far. So please, please, if that is you, apply. If you know someone, such a great opportunity, please tell them about that. Applications close on the 13th of March. Links below. So yes, using skew transformations is no longer needed because computers are now powerful enough to do rotations. I mean, skews were easier to do back in the day, but now the GPU can rotate things and we have so many pixels. We know it's a bit sad, but we no longer care about any one individual pixel. But I like it. It's a really retro, it's a hipster way to rotate things. So I'm gonna finish by rotating through all 360 degrees, here I go, and keep my arms like out on the edges because I didn't really bother dealing with the edge cases. So who knows what's happening with these. Thanks again to Jane Street for sponsoring the video. Do check out AMP or tell someone else about it. And yeah, watch whatever video is on the screen now, wherever it is. Good luck, and maybe subscribe. I'm gonna keep doing this until my laptop melts, which is holding up pretty.